Subject for today is yoga, the 8 points on that. Hope you are all able to hear the end. The 8 points of yoga, usually they call it as 8 steps, but according to me, it is not 8 separate steps, it is 8 points. It is, step means you finish the first and go to the second, finish the second and go to the third, but this doesn't seem like that. It's like you will be practicing all the 8 at a time. You need to know all the 8 at a time. Unless you have a glimpse of the 8th step samadhi, you can't achieve the perfection in the first step yama, the disciplines. One small request, today I will be speaking few Sanskrit words. I request, if you don't understand at any time, I will be always giving the Sanskrit, the English translation of the Sanskrit words. If you feel that you are not able to understand the translation or my accent or any concept, you are welcome to stop me and put any questions so that I will give you a little more explanation. Please don't miss any point. Even if you miss single point, you will not be able to understand the next level. Only when you know all the 8 points, it will do something to your life. I always tell people, never collect any information, any knowledge, which you are not going to use it, which is not useful. So, if you are just sitting here to collect a little more knowledge, then be very clear, it's not something great. Or if you are sitting here to get something and transform your life, to use it in your life and transform your life, then it's something really great. It's worth sitting. It's worth spending. Your time is worth spending. Only if you are here for transformation of the life. Those who are joined today, just for them, I'll give a few introduction points which I spoke yesterday. Patanjali is a great mystic. I call him as a saintist. Saint and scientist, both together. A saintist who wrote this great book, Yoga Sutra, means the aphorisms of yoga. We are going to enter into the aphorisms of yoga. Yoga means union with God. You should understand one important point. In the West, we always think yoga is just a set of body postures. Of course, it is body postures also, but it is not only that much. It is something more than body postures. It is not only for the body, it is for the mind and the soul and your whole being. Yoga means union. Parjari gives 8 points or 8 steps to experience the ultimate union with the divine, with the universal consciousness. Eight techniques he gives to enter into the universal consciousness. Before entering into these 8 steps or 8 points, yesterday we had a beautiful question. One of our devotees asked, Swamiji, all these techniques can be practiced only by mind, which is after all a tree. How can these techniques awaken us? How can one more tree awaken us from our dreams? Today we'll analyze that question a little bit. Then we'll enter into the points. First thing, when you see a lion chasing you in your dreams, or when you see some nightmare, automatically you just wake up. You come out of the dream and you come to the waking conscious state. Same way, anything which gives you deep fear or greed, you can see, if you analyze your dreams, you can understand. If it creates too much of greed or too much of desires, both will bring you out of the dream state. Whether it is nightmare or fantasy dreams, both will bring you out of dreams. If it is nightmare, it will put you into the fear and you will be out of the dreams. If it is fantasy dreams, too much of greed, excessive greed, again you will be out of dreams. You will be in waking consciousness. You will be in waking state. All Patanjali does is he adds something into your being so that you will have some terrific dreams and you wake up. You will just wake up. Beautiful. There is a beautiful story in Zen Buddhism. One person goes to a master and asks, Master, how can I become awakened, enlightened? Master says, just slap your face and get up. Nothing else. Slap your face and get up. All you need to do is only one thing. Just wake up. You will be out of the dreams. Sometimes we will not be able to slap ourselves. So Patanjali teaches us 8 methods how to slap ourselves technically and wake up. He is adding something so that we can have either a nightmare or fantasy dream and wake up to the ultimate consciousness. Ultimate consciousness. These 8 steps, the more you practice, the more the clarity descends on you. I can say one thing for sure. I have not seen any other master, any other book speaking so clearly, with such a perfection, such a straightforward way. He is just a scientist. A plus B equal to C, that's all. Usually mystics never speak the language of mathematics. They say A, put A, then B, maybe the C or D will come. The C did not appear. No, I think you don't have enough faith. You did not put A plus properly, be properly. Usually this is the language mystics speak. This is the language spiritual people speak. But here is a person, is straight and clear cut, is sharp. He says, no, A plus B is C. No doubts. He is ready to bet. He can guarantee. I think he has got so much of confidence about the product which he is marketing, and he is so clear, only Patanjali can use the word money back guarantee in the whole spiritual world. The word money back guarantee can be used only by Patanjali, because he is so sharp, so clear, you cannot miss him. You cannot miss him. With any other system, there is a possibility some will catch and some will miss. It's always percentage. Every system, only percentage. 80% catches, 20 misses, or 60 catches, 40 misses, or 40 catches, 60 misses. But with Patanjali, I can say 110% people will catch. Why I say 110%? Not only the people who are in the planet Earth and who are in the planet Earth, who will be in the planet Earth also can catch. Because he has created such a foolproof system, not only for the past minds and the present minds, he can work for the future minds also. He has already predicted all possible complications mind can create and given solution. In the modern days, they say pesticides, which they are using for agriculture purposes to kill the insects. They say if you use a particular pesticide for 1 year, the insects slowly they became so strong, they get immune to that pesticide. Next year, if you use the same pesticide, they start eating and surviving. They start surviving the pesticide. So next year, naturally, you have to improve the strength. You have to increase the strength. Every year, you need to increase the strength of the pesticide to kill the insects, because the insects learn the art of surviving the pesticides. Same way, our mind also learns the art of surviving the masters. Again and again, masters create techniques to go beyond the mind. But the mind is so cunning, it learns the techniques. We all have survived Buddhas. We all have survived Shankaras. We all have survived Krishnas. We all have survived Christ. We are surviving the masters because we became more cunning. Our mind becomes more cunning. We know the methods to escape from the techniques. But with Patanjali, there is no need for any updating or pesticide. He has created such a strong mechanism, a system. You don't need to update it. Simply it will work. At any time, simply you can't survive Patanjali. You can't survive Patanjali. Simply you have to become enlightened. You have to reach a state. No other way. Say Patanjali is the perfect master, because he has not left even a single chance. That is why his tradition is still alive. As I was telling you, if you see from the practical point, from the practical aspect, he is the master who has inspired more number of people on the planet Earth. Practically, he is the leading person in the spiritual field. Almost all the masters are directly or indirectly inspired by him. Let us enter into the first step. The first step in Sanskrit it is called yama, means discipline. Yama. We don't have solid English word. I'll translate the concept. Discipline. We can say discipline. Means tuning yourself to the ultimate. The discipline does not mean do's and don'ts. Please be very clear. That is the reason the yama word cannot be translated as the discipline. Discipline means you understand always do's and don'ts. But yama is not something to do with do's and don'ts. It just gives you some instruction to tune yourself to your being. I can say yama means tuning to yourself. Trying to tune yourself to your self. Smaller self to higher self. First comes ahimsa, means non-violence. Here non-violence is not preached as a morality, no. It is given as a technique. Important understanding. Usually, non-violence is always taught to us as a morality. If you are non-violent, you will reach heaven. If you are violent, you will reach hell. It is like morality. You will be rewarded or punished. But I tell you, no morality can be practiced. Advice is the one thing which everybody is ready to give, nobody wants to take. Everybody is ready to give, nobody wants to take. No morality actually can be practiced. It's very difficult to practice any morality. And if at all you are successful in practicing some morality, be very clear, we will be schizophrenous. God saved us, we will not be able to practice any morality. You master any morality, you will be just schizophrenia, suppressed, depressed. I tell you, if you understand and practice, it can never be a discipline. It will be just falling in tune. It will be just tuning yourself. Here, non-violence is not given as a morality. No. No concept of hell or heaven. If you are supposed to follow morality only based on the fear of hell or the greed for heaven, I don't think we have grown. All morality should be based on consciousness, not on conscience. Morality based on conscience is only skin deep. You know the depth of skin. You know that? Depth of skin. If you are a child, you can be made to do something, or you can be threatened not to do something with some reward or punishment. If you don't do that, I will not give you candy. If you do that, I will give you Barbie doll. Don't do that, I'll punish you. If you do that, I will reward you. It is okay for a child, but not for a grown-up man. Even after grown-up, even after becoming an adult, if you need somebody to based on the fear and greed. You need the hell and heaven. Means we have not grown. Still we are child. It's not even childlike, childish. Childlike is different and childish is different. Be very clear. Morality should be only based on consciousness, not on conscience. Here he speaks beautifully. Patanjali says, Ahimsa. Ahimsa means non-violence. Non-violence is supposed to be followed with an understanding. He doesn't make this a law, no law. If it is law, naturally you will try to rebel when the cop is not around you. You know, if there is no cop front at the back, and naturally you speed up. And it gives you a taste. I tell you, the moment you break some law, you feel you are somebody great. Kids, the moment they say no to their father, mother, they feel they have become adult. Why do you think? Again and again kids say no to father, no to father, mother. Whatever you may say, simply all they know is no. Because they feel they become adult, they become somebody. The moment they learn how to say no, as long as they are saying yes, they feel still they want to mature. The moment they learn the art of saying no, they think they have grown up. Same way, the moment you get some chance, you try to violate that rule. Any rule gives you the inspiration to violate that rule. As long as it does not become understanding, either you will be trying to get some time to violate. If you don't violate and just leave the truth, you will have a deep dissatisfaction that you have not lived your life. Please be very clear. These are the dangers of rules. These are the dangers of morality. I tell you, all the suffering, all the depression, all the violence on the planet Earth is just because of the rules without giving you understanding. Just because of the rules, if you don't follow, naturally there will be so many problems. And if you follow, you will feel as if you are not living your life. You are living the life according to somebody else. So no rules will give you the satisfaction. That is why I replace the word conscience with a beautiful word consciousness. Not discipline, falling in tune. No discipline, only yama. Yama means falling in tune. Patanjali explains every concept. He says again and again, yama, the first step of yama is non-violence. Non-violence with understanding why we should not be violent. Not because you are going to get heaven or you will not be put in the hell. And I tell you one important thing. Actually, you don't do some mistake and reach hell. You do mistake because you are in hell. Why are you violent? Because you are not happy with yourself. Only when you are not easy with yourself, you are not happy with yourself, you are not comfortable with yourself, we are violent towards others. If you are ease with yourself, if you are happy with yourself, if you are relaxed with yourself, you will never be violent. See, in your own life, if you are happy, cool, comfortable, comfortably, joyfully. Even if somebody does a mistake, he'll say, all right, leave it. Leave it, it's okay, we'll adjust. What to do? We'll do something. If you are agitated, restless, not easy with yourself, even if people don't do mistakes, what you will do? You try to find something. Because you have to vomit out. You have to vomit the violence which is inside. The uneasy feeling which is in your being. I tell you, never think you will do some mistake and go to hell. You do mistake because you are in hell. Same way, never think you will do some good and go to heaven. You do good things because you are in heaven. Doing itself is a reward. The mentality or the easiness which you experience at the time of doing good, that itself is a reward. You don't need a separate reward. If you do some good things for the sake of some reward, please be very clear, you are creating hell for yourself. And I tell you, there is no exchange offer. If you give 45 rupees in India, you will have $1 in America, money exchange counter. I tell you honestly, there is no money exchange counter between this world and the other world. Don't think, if you do some charity, you will have the VIP pass there, speed pass, no. Do charity just out of joy, out of the spirit of sharing. You have it? Let's share. Just out of that understanding and sharing spirit, do charity. Never expecting that you have a special flight taking you there, carrying on all. Special arrangements will be made for you there. Saint Peter will be standing in the pearly gates and receiving you. And please don't imagine all those things. Any morality or any discipline, if it is based on fear and greed, it is not going to lead you anywhere except hell. It will not even lead to hell. You will be in hell. Any morality should be only based on understanding. Here, he gives the understanding. If you are established in non-violence, even the animals in front of you will forget the idea of violence. They will drop violence. You will start radiating such wonderful love, such an ecstasy, such a grace, such a beautiful energy, such wonderful aura. Your very being will be a blessing to the planet Earth. Ahimsa pratishtaya vairatyaha. The Sanskrit aphorism says, man who is established in non-violence, in his presence, even the enemies, even the animals will drop their enmity and vengeance and start radiating the love. There is a wonderful story. A great enlightened master, Shankara, he is one of the great masters who happened on the planet Earth. India has contributed many enlightened masters to the planet Earth. He is one of the great masters contributed by the planet Earth, contributed by India to the planet Earth. we say Patanjali is a technician who created techniques, who created an engineering for enlightenment. We can say Shankara is a man who created dictionary. He created an unabridged dictionary of world philosophies. In his life, beautiful incident happened. He was going all over India by walk. And in India, there is a tradition. If you are to become a master, if you are to become a teacher, you have to go from village to village, beg door to door, and live with the common public. Unless you live with common public, you live with a layman, you will not know what they actually need. All the problem in the modern day society is the people who teach, they are outdated. They studied 40 years ago. They don't know what is going on with the modern man today. No way of updating themselves. Neither they are interested nor compelled. That is the reason something lacks, or we are missing something in our life. In India, anybody who is supposed to become a teacher or a master, he has to go from village to village. Length and breadth of India, he should walk. He was wandering, learning from many great masters, many experienced persons, learning from many universities, from different traditions. In India, every city will be built around the university, the spiritual university. In my own village, the village in which I am born and brought up, there is a temple which is a spiritual university, 27 acre built up area with pure granite stone. Pure granite stone, 27 acre built up area. And the tower, it has got 9 tower. The height of one tower is 217 feet. Understand? All their power, all their energy is diverted in constructing, creating spiritual universities. So each one, anybody who wants to become master should go around learning different universities. He went around, learned. Now he is searching for a spot, for a place where he should create his own university and where he should settle down and start teaching. He is searching for a place. He decides, I want to spread love and the feeling of oneness. His teaching is called Advaita, oneness, non-duality. I want to spread this love. I will create a place, I will settle down in a place where the love energy radiates, where the energy of love is in the peak. He decides, he will settle down in a place where the aura of love, or the energy of love, is in its peak. He goes from, at one place he sees, in a forest, on the bank of a river, in a forest he sees, the night was a Purnima night, moon is shining, and it is drizzling. Slowly rain started. One frog is about to give birth, about to deliver a baby, baby frog. So it was raining. So nearby, one big Raja, we call it cobra, wants to deliver a baby and it's raining, just to protect that frog, cobra just took his food and he was protecting that frog. You know, cobras, the moment they see the frog, what they do? They swallow. They are basically enemies. And frog also, the moment it sees the cobra, it just escapes. Here, the cobra is protecting, the frog is delivering. When Shankara saw this scene, he was just shocked. This is the place where I should create my university. Animals lose their enmity. The idea of enmity is totally lost. Such a pure feeling of oneness starts happening. Such a pure love starts happening. And I tell you, if you experience that love, if you understand that love, you will never become violent again. Not for the sake of hell, not for the sake of heaven, not because of the fear or greed. Just the ecstasy of that love is enough. You will never become violent. Simply you will become non-violent. Simply the non-violence will happen to you. Because that very love itself is such a wonderful thing. Such an ecstatic, deep bliss. You will never become again. Even think of violence. As of now, all our non-violence is just show, mask. Deep down, we are violent. Look into your life. If somebody falls, you rush, try to help. But how much you have to struggle to suppress your laughter? Tell me honestly. If somebody falls, what will be the first reaction? Automatically inside you, giggle. And you have to suppress yourself. Somehow you have to manage to be polite. Many times, socially, we express the sympathy, but inside we feel. We feel good about the things. We don't know actually what we are doing. Small story. I brought a beautiful story for you. I'll read out. Ananda Pappaya woke up to find himself in the hospital with his friend sitting beside him. Shocked, Pappaya asked his friend, "What happened last night?" Sadly, his friend replied, "You know, Pappaya, at last night's party, after drinking too much, you declared that you are going to parachute down from the fourth floor through the window." Pappaya exclaimed, "Why did not you stop me, you fool?" Friend replies, "Because last night I thought you could do it." He was also drunk. Friend was also drunk. Many times, we don't know what we are doing. And after things happen, we sympathize or try to sympathize. And inside, we just have a good time. We enjoy. What's happening? All right. Let's have a good time. Non-violence is supposed to be from an ecstasy of love, the bliss which you experience from love. I tell you, when you experience love, you expand and feel oneness with everybody. Just because of that oneness, just because of that oneness only, you start being non-violent. Non-violence never comes by practice. It comes only by experience. Practice is different, experience is different. Please be very clear. It comes only by the experience of love, taste of love, or the bliss of love. And I tell you, whether you believe it or not, accept it or not, realize it or not, the whole universe responds to our thoughts. Let me tell you one of my experience. After enlightenment, I was staying in a forest, in a dark cave. It's very dark. One day I was sitting just at the entrance of the cave, trying to relax, not even meditating, just my eyes are open, but I am totally indrawn. I was sitting with myself. Next to me, just 2-3 feet, a big cobra was lying, poisonous snake was lying. But the beauty is, I was so indrawn. I was completely within myself. I was not even aware the cobra is lying next to me. My eyes are open, but the mind is not associated with eyes. Sometimes, if you are reading something very seriously, even if people press calling bell, you will not hear the sound. If alarm goes on, you will not hear the sound. Ears are open, but mind is not associated with ears. Same way, eyes are open, but my mind is not associated with the eyes. I was just sitting. How the birds hatch the eggs. When they hatch the eggs, they will be sitting with eyes open, but their mind will not be with the eyes. So I was just sitting with myself. Cobra was lying. Maybe after half an hour, suddenly, when I was settling into the body, I saw the cobra. Means earlier also I was seeing, but suddenly the thought came in my mind, cobra. I was seeing, my eyes were open. Because my mind is so indrawn, I was indrawn, the thought cobra never occurred in me. The moment, actually, I became slowly extroverted, I started settling into the body. And the moment the thought came, cobra, I could see very clearly the cobra had the thought, man. So as long as I did not think it's cobra, the cobra never thought I'm a man. It was just lying happily, in a very relaxed way. Neither I was threatened by cobra and now the cobra was threatened by me. Both of us are eased with our presence. We are just enjoying each other's company. He was comfortable with me and I was comfortable with him. Both were happy, just sitting next to each other. The moment I had the thought cobra, the cobra had the thought man. And the next thought, the usual fear. And the moment the usual thinking trend started, I saw the same thing is reflected, the same thing is happening in cobra also. When I looked, that also raised the head and looked. The moment I started moving, just it moved and went away. I started moving back and that also started going away. As long as I did not have the thought, it is cobra. The cobra did not have the thought, I am a man. The moment I had a thought, that also responded. You should understand one important thing. When we are established in the love, nothing touches us. We don't have to defend ourselves continuously. The idea of defending only creates all the possibility or inspiration to affront others. See, every country claims their army is defensive army. Then who is offending? Tell me. Every country claims their army is defense. Every country names their army as a defensive army. Defense army. Have you heard any country saying their army as offense army? Any country naming their force as offensive army force? No. All countries claim, name their army force as a defensive army force. Then who is offending? Who is offending? The very idea defending will make you offend others. The more you try to defend, what you will do? I think better. Let me put one step ahead and defend myself. Naturally, you will be entering inside his boundary and trying to defend yourself. And he is also waiting to enter into your boundary and defend himself. Violence starts. Our idea about defense is a pure violence. And I tell you, don't think it is impractical. No. Never think what I am saying is impractical. It is very practical. We always think, no, how can we be alive without protecting ourselves? I tell you, now you protect yourself so much. What we have experienced in our life, except the pain and sufferings, is there anything else worthy we achieve? No. I tell you, even if you are exploited, if you live radiating love, you will be a god on the planet Earth. You will live like a god on the planet Earth. You will just have such wonderful being. You will be a god on the planet Earth. You will be like a flower on the planet Earth. And if you take the other choice to continuously defend yourself, I tell you, how much you defend yourself, you can defend yourself from the neighbors, from your society, from other human beings, from animals, all for 100 years. After that, you can't defend yourself from death. And one day we have to leave. By defending yourself, you may add life to your, you may add years to your life. Please understand. By defending yourself, you may add years to your life by trusting, by loving, you will add life to your years. These two things. You want to add years to your life or life to your years? It's your choice. By defending, you will add years to your life. By loving, by trusting, by opening up, you will add life to your years. What do you want? You have to choose. It's up to you to choose. When you understand the power of love, the ecstasy of love, not only you will not be non-violent, you will not feel you are a great person by being non-violent. One big trouble. People who start practicing this non-violence, they develop such a big ego. I tell you this, so-called goody-goody people. The idea, holier than thou, I am holier than you. This is the most cunning, violent attitude. You can trust an atheist, but never this so-called goody-goody people. Atheists may be more honest, but the so-called goody-goody people, they will have so much of covered ego that I am holier than you. If you start practicing non-violence, you will radiate violence in a cunning way. You will start claiming, I am holier than you. You are under me. I am holy person. I am great person. You don't know who I am. Always carrying a big board. Billboard. Putting all their qualities. Big billboard. And if you experience the energy of love, not only you will not be non-violent, you will not feel you are doing something great. You will be non-violent in a very ordinary way. There was a great enlightened master, Suzuki, a Zen master. One of the great master. Somebody asked him, Master, what is the greatness of your master? What's the extraordinary thing you found in him? Suzuki replies, the most extraordinary thing I found in him is he always thought he is very ordinary. People who think extraordinary, they are all ordinary. Please be very clear. Every one of us have a feeling inside our being that we are extraordinary. We don't say it very loudly because it is too egoistic. But in a very mild way, in a very nice way, polite way, my religion is great, my country is great, my race is great, my language is great. Why do you think again and again we claim, my city is great, my religion is great, my country is great, my language is great, my race is great? You can't straight away say I am great. So naturally we have to be a little polite and just say it in a roundabout way. We can't straight away say it. It looks too egoistic. So we have to express it only in a roundabout way. That is why we claim, my race is great. My religion is great. My country is great. My language is great. We always think we are extraordinary. We are extraordinary. But I tell you, anybody who thinks extraordinary, that is enough, he is ordinary. If you think you are extraordinary, be very clear, that is enough to make you understand you are ordinary. Suzuki says, I have never seen anybody who thought himself as so ordinary as my master. That makes him extraordinary. When you live in an ordinary way, you simply become extraordinary. No extraordinary person thinks he is extraordinary. Please be very clear. Somebody came and asked me, Swamiji, am I enlightened? I have a doubt. I told him, as long as you have doubt, please be very clear, you are not enlightened. The moment you become enlightened, not only you will not have a doubt whether you are enlightened or not, I tell you honestly, you will not even think you are enlightened. People ask me, people who live around me, they ask me, Swamiji, whatever you said and done, how could you live such an ordinary life, such an ease life? I don't take myself for granted. I don't even think that I am enlightened. A real enlightened person will not even remember that he is enlightened. Will not even think he is enlightened. He will not even have thought he is enlightened. Do you always sit and think, I am Sheila, I am Sheila, I am Sheila? Do you repeat your name? No. You don't continuously sit and think, I am this, I am this, I am this. No. If you are that, you are that, that's all. You don't think, you don't remember. Same way, a real enlightened person never even thinks he is enlightened. And he just lives. An extraordinary person will not even think he is extraordinary. It will be so ordinary, such an ordinary life. That's one more reason why we miss enlightened people. They will be very ordinary. If you live around them, they will be so ordinary, you can't find any difference. You can't find any difference. People always worship and respect the dead masters, ancient masters. Why? Because a lot of stories are created around them. They are projected as extraordinary. But with the living masters, they are so ordinary, difficult to recognize them. If you come and stay in the place where I am, if you come and see where I am staying, there is a restroom in my room. I also use the bathroom. I also eat like, just like you all. I just live just like you all. But when you read the lives of ancient masters, you don't read or remember whether they used restroom or not. And no master's life says whether they used restroom or not. It's not recorded. So only the miracles are recorded. Only the peak incidents are recorded. Only the extraordinary things are lived. And the biography is created. Ordinary things are forgotten. The mundane things are missed. So you always think enlightenment means something extraordinary. I tell you, you will become so ordinary. You will just radiate ordinariness. You will radiate ordinariness. When you experience the glimpse of the love, not only you will not be violent, you will not boast yourself that you are non-violent. You will not even think you are great because you are non-violent. You will not even feel you are someway extraordinary. Next, Patanjali says, the next point, in the first point, there is a 5 points. In the five points, we have finished one and we are going to second. I love him so much, I can't finish him. actually, when you start talking about somebody whom you love, whom you feel very near and dear, you can't finish. You can't end. It will just go on, go on, go on forever. You can never end. When you talk about some of your enemies, naturally in 2-3 minutes you say, enough, stop talking about him, let's go something else. The person whom you don't feel comfortable or happy, you say, enough, let's talk about something else. Let's go to something else. Let's change the subject. But when you talk about somebody whom you love, whom you really enjoy, with whom you feel comfortable, not only you can't end, it goes on and on and on. The next wonderful point, first he said non-violence, then he says brahmacharya. This word has to be understood. Normally this word is translated as celibacy, but it is wrong. Please understand, the brahmacharya Sanskrit word cannot be translated by the English word celibacy. No. Celibacy is dead, suppressing, perversion, all possible problems. I tell you, HIV is the greatest gift given to the planet Earth by the so-called celibates. The word brahmacharya should be understood in a much more deeper way. Brahma means existence, reality. Charya means living with it. Living with it. Brahmacharya means living with reality. People come and ask me, Swamiji, to become a yogi, should I leave my wife and kids? And should I become a Swami? Should I become a celibate? I tell them, no. Just renounce what you don't have, that's enough. You don't have to renounce what you have. If you have one wife, live with her happily, intensely. Only renounce the fantasies which you don't have, but which you try to have. See, your fantasies are the wives whom you don't have, but you try to live with them. Just renounce what you don't have, that is enough. Live with what you have. Live intensely, happily, as deeply as possible with what you have. All you need to do is just renounce what you don't have. That's enough. Renouncing what you don't have is what is meant by the word brahmacharya. Just drop the fantasies. Just drop things which you don't have in your life, but with which you are living. There are so many things are not in your, available in your life, but continuously you are living with it. You are living with it. Whether it is about your car, or about your house, or about your wife, or about your husband. Live with what you have. Drop the fantasies. A real wife, a real husband is perfectly all right. Just drop your fantasy husbands, your fantasy boys, your fantasies about wife, your fantasies about husband. Accept the other person as he is or as she is. Accepting the reality. Living with reality is what is meant by the word brahmacharya. If we translate the word brahmacharya into celibacy, I tell you, not even 1% of the world can become yogis. Leave about 1%, not even 0.01%. Not even 0.01%. Once you become enlightened, only that extraordinary energy happens to you, and you just live like a flower. Live like a flower. And I tell you, the yogis, the so-called modern-day yogis, have done a very big mistake by translating this word brahmacharya with the English word celibacy. No. In Sanskrit, original Sanskrit, it means living with reality. Brahma means reality, existence. Charya means living with. Living like or living the existence. Living the existence is what we should understand by the word brahmacharya. You don't need to renounce what you have. Just renounce what you don't have. That's enough. If you renounce what you don't have, you will not renounce what you have. Two things. Either you live with your fantasies or you live with your real wife. When you live with your real beloved, you drop your fantasies and your life becomes heaven, ecstasy, joy. If you live with your fantasies, naturally you will feel uncomfortable with your real wife and you will drop, choose something else, somebody else. Again, when you come near, you will understand she is also not matching your fantasies. Again, you will drop. Again, after that, you will search somebody and you will come upon with somebody. You will understand she is also not matching your fantasy and it will go on and on and on. I tell you, the idea of beauty or fantasy is just an idea. It is not reality. Where is the scale of beauty? Tell me. As long as the things are maintained, as long as you maintain a distance, everything looks beautiful. When you look from long distance, long shot, things really look beautiful. When you come close, everything becomes flat. Everything becomes normal. I tell you one important secret. Even if you marry the Miss Universe or the best great model, the idea about beauty will be there only for 15 days. Because in your movies and dreams, you have different fantasies. But in reality, it will be totally different. The moment you start living together, you start staying together, naturally, the idea of beauty will disappear. The idea of beauty will disappear. It will stay only for 15 days. That is why we have a beautiful word, honeymoon. Not honey sun. Have you heard the word honey sun? Why it is honeymoon? Your moon will stay only for 15 days. This emotion also will stay only for 15 days. That is why honeymoon. When you start living with reality, when you start accepting her as she is, without bringing your fantasies in the front, without trying to mold her as you want, you will live ecstatic life. You will be surprised. In India, people stay together even for 60, 70 years. Actually, When I tell them that in some other countries people marry even twice or thrice, they get shocked. Usually, I can say even 80%. 80% in Indian culture, they stay together forever. In Hinduism, the idea of divorce never exists. There is no idea of divorce. According to Hindu marriage laws, the divorce is not possible. And I want to tell you one important thing. Still, we don't have a Sanskrit equivalent word for divorce. We don't have a Sanskrit word for divorce. Divorce as such, the very idea is not socially accepted. Because before the marriage, they are very clearly made to understand nobody can suit or match your fantasies. Either you live with your fantasies and get frustrated after seeing 5-6 persons, or drop your fantasies and live with one person happily forever. Only in the fairy tales you get the word they lived forever happily. They lived forever happily married. Only in the fairy tales you can get the word, not in reality. In reality, only when you drop your fantasies, you can experience of you can experience what I call Brahmacharya. Brahmacharya is nothing to do with outer man or outer woman. Outer man or outer woman can never disturb your Brahmacharya. If they are disturbing, it is not worth having. It's an inner man or inner woman who disturbs you, not the outer man or outer woman. And I have seen some of these so-called celibates, these suppressive people, they will be always attention because they are sitting on a volcano. Any moment they will open. Any moment they can break. They are afraid. They are afraid. And they can't look into your eyes because you can find out what is there in their mind. They are afraid to look into your eyes. Neither their eyes can be relaxed, nor their body can be relaxed. They can't have vacation. The moment they sit with themselves, all the fantasies come up. They have all possible dreams, all possible perversions. What to do? Nothing can be done. In India, there is a faith or stories. If you are meditating and trying to practice celibacy, from the higher worlds, from heaven, they will send the dancing girls of heaven to tempt you. There are stories on so-called meditator. Of course, his name is Vishwamitra, before enlightenment. After enlightenment, he became a real master. That is different. There are some stories says that before his enlightenment, the heavenly celestial girls came and tempted him, and he fell from his vows. And I tell you, nobody sends you any woman. Nobody is sitting there and alerting people, oh, he is meditating, go and disturb him. He is trying to meditate, go and disturb him. If That is the case, everybody will start meditating. If at all they are going to get heavenly women, they will start meditating. I don't think this is the case. These people, when they suppress too much, they start seeing their fantasies. They start seeing illusions. They start hallucinating because of their suppressed fantasies. I can be sure that this guy also started hallucinating because of his suppression. I don't think anybody is sitting there allotting duty. All right, today Ramba, you go there and disturb this guy. Today you go to South Zone and disturb all those guys. No. No heavenly girls or salvation women are sent to disturb these people. They disturb themselves because of suppression. I tell you, the brahmacharya should not be practiced as a morality. It should happen as an understanding. When you drop the inner woman, start living with the outer woman intensely, something extraordinary happens between you and your beloved. You start accepting the other person as he is or as she is. When you accept the other person as he is or as she is, you start accepting yourself as you are. When you start accepting the other person as he is or as she is, you start accepting yourself as you are, huh? You start accepting yourself as you are. In a way, brahmacharya also has to be experienced, or you have to fall in tune with it, not to be practiced, but to be experienced. Next beautiful word, satya. Satya means the truthfulness. Please be very clear, not factfulness. Being factual is not being truthful. When Patanjali says satya, he means the truth. Not being factual. People understand. Satya means being factual, telling the facts as it is. No. That is not satya. Satya is something more. Living the truth. Not only speaking the truth. Speaking the truth, any fool can do. I think only fools do. That's not a big thing. Speaking the truth is not a big thing. Living the truth. When Patanjali says satya, he means something more than being factual. Actually, I tell you, important secret. If you have to break any law, all you need to do is, you don't have to go against the law. Just follow it verbally, verbatim. Simply you will break the spirit. You start following verbatim, literally, you'll break the spirit. Two things. Catching the spirit or catching the letter. When you catch the letter, there is every possibility you will miss the spirit. How do you think? Why do you think people fight in the name of God? Jesus says, love thy neighbors as you love thyself. Krishna says again and again, I am in everybody. See me in everybody and love everybody as you love myself. Every master says we have to spread love, we have to radiate love. But finally, what happens? Why so much of religious terrorism? Why so much of violence? They catch the letter, not the spirit. They catch the letter, not the spirit. They catch the personality, not the principle. Each one wants to spread the peace and love as they want, not what others feel. The so-called preachers of love and peace, they are the people who create all possible chaos. If you say you are already in peace and you are already happy, they will say, no, you have to be peaceful or loving as we want you, not as you are. If you are already peaceful, then how will we have charm? Three friends, one great preacher and a lawyer and doctor, all the three were sitting and discussing. The doctor said, God must be a doctor. Others asked, how can it be? Because he removed one rib and created Eve. He removed one rib from Adam and created Eve. So he must be a doctor. Lawyer said, no. He must have been a lawyer or a judge. Others asked, how? Because he was giving judgment. He was trying to pacify the problems of Adam and Eve. The preacher said, no, he is a preacher. I know for sure. Others asked, how? Arey, before the Adam and Eve, Bible says there was a chaos. Who would have created it? Who else can create the chaos? He must have been a preacher. Most of the time, it's they who create chaos so that they will have their business. When you just catch the letter, not the spirit, you create chaos. Rama, the great incarnation of India, his birthplace, he named that city as Ayodhya. Ayodhya means where there is no war. Yuddha means war. Ayodhya means where there will be no more wars, where peace will radiate. And if you know a little bit about India, you will know. Today, that is the biggest controversy of India. So much of violence is going on just because of that one place. The whole spirit of Rama is lost. All he wants is that city should be peaceful without wars. That is why he named that city as Ayodhya. That was his fantasy. That was his idea. But the followers, they catch the letter, not the spirit. A small story, beautiful story. There was a great enlightened master living in the banks of Ganges, India's holy river. he had one copy of holy book, the Hindu holy book, Bhagavad Gita. He used to read that book. He used to worship that book. That book is the only property which he want. And almost that book has become his life. It has become part of his life. One day, every day he used to sit and pray with that book, read that book, and recite it and pray to the God or practice it. One day, a poor guy, old man, came and begged, "Sir, please give me something. I have not eaten for the last 2 days. I am hungry. Please help me." The master felt deeply moved. He thought, "I am myself a beggar. What can I give you? I have nothing except this one book. I can do one thing. Please take this book and go to the market. I am very popular and respected in this city. And go to the market and auction this book. Say that this book is from me. This is from that enlightened person. So many of my disciples are there. They will surely give some money and purchase this book. Because they know that this is the only property. And this is the only thing which I keep. So they all respect this book. They will purchase this book and give you money. Have that money and eat and be happy. This is the only thing I can do." This beggar said, "Okay, please give me. I'm happy." The master gave that book to him and the beggar went away. Next day morning the time for prayer came. He is supposed to open this book and pray, but there is no book. He has already given away that book. Now he says, "Oh God, I have given away your words to keep your words." He prays, "I have given away your words to keep your words." The story says, immediately Lord appeared and blessed him. "My son, you have done what I said. You have caught the spirit, not the letter." When you catch the letter, you always miss the spirit. Being factual does not mean being truthful. Being factual is very easy. Speaking only the facts is very easy. And you can play with words in such a way, you can always prove that you spoke only facts and do what you want. All you need is only little intelligence. A little logic can always save so-called facts and do what you want. So much of corruption is there in all the countries, in all the fields, because we understood this satya as being factual, not as truthful. Being factual means speaking the fact through your words. But truth is living the truth not only through your verbal language, through your body language also. Truth is something more than being factual. The truth has got three dimensions. One is speaking the truth, thinking the truth, and expressing the truth in your life. The three dimensions of the truth, if you understand, only then you can call yourself, you are truthful. Are you fallen in tune with truth, satya? tomorrow you will see all three dimensions of truth.